does the intersectionality of patriarchy and sexism play a role, or how did that, do you think, play a role in the Breonna Taylor case, both in her execution and in the lack of accountability for her assassination? Because I do think that those things were all at play. Anybody want to start? DeLacy? Then we'll go to Jewel.
I have a different view, because I think that Black people, period, have been ignored in this country relative to law enforcement. So I understand, me being a father of daughters and you being a woman, I understand how you see it through the lens that you see it through, but I see it through a very broader lens, and that is Black people, period, have been treated similarly by law enforcement. In fact, this is probably the loudest pushback that I've seen and heard since Rodney King. And that's gotta be 30, almost 40 years. So they just haven't done it. I mean, they've been killing Black people since Rodney King. So certainly Black women have gotten even less attention, but I think Black people as a collective, and I say that clearly that way, because I'm not inclined to separate Black women from Black men, because I think that's part and parcel of the problem that gets exploited, right? It gets exploited in such a way that I think that Black men even look at Black women differently, because there are conversations that I have with men. I say, you know, I'm a father of daughters, so you can't tell me that and get me to sign off, because I don't think that my daughter is lesser than my son. I don't think my daughter deserves less than your son. And so at the end of the day, I have a I'm a girl dad, as I say, and I'm responsible for making sure that my girls are protected, both my birth daughter and my adopted daughters and my community daughters. So I think that, like I said, I understand the perspective, and I think there's truth to the perspective, but I think that grandma was born 1901, died 1982, the youngest of 10 children, all her aunts and uncles were slaves. And so when grandma tells me the story, I understand that aunties were raped every day. That's how you get babies that look like me. You know, so it didn't just start here with the police. I mean, you come here darker than 1,000 beautiful midnights and end up light bright, damn near white like me, because somebody's putting cream in the coffee and loving it, and it ain't just Mr. McDonald.
All right, yes, we are recording. Thank you everybody for joining Stop Brutalizing Black Bodies podcast, hosted by Lisa Durden, moi. It's a platform that I created to amplify Black voices unapologetically, bringing in our featured dope AF contributors every week. And I'm gonna say, it's a movement. Right.
All right.
Let's clap for that. Yeah. Let's
clap
it up for that. You know, we try to clap it up for ourselves with these sad times. So let me do a quick introduction of my panelists. You're going to come on a lot of time. So in the first couple of episodes, we'll do a more in-depth introduction. But as we go along over the years, they'll know you more. So let's talk about who's here today, and we're going to get this party started. We have Jewel Cadet, the Ratchet Revolutionary. She's also a social justice organizer and the host of Jewel's Gems on IG. It's a live talk show. Her social justice organizing spans across all areas of girls, femmes, transgender, gender nonconforming communities, and of course the Black community. She's also the director of programs at the Center for Anti-Violence Education. So she's savage, classy, bougie, and ratchet, as I pick on her all the time and say. Well, hold on for a second. So who else do we have here? Hold on for a second. And I was going to have Larry, but Larry wasn't able to come. So Larry, we know you're here in spirit. Larry Ham is running for Senate, so I guess he's out there stomping the pavement. So we'll move on. We have Rosalind Charles Esquire. She's a former municipal judge, so she knows everything. She's been on all sides of the law except for as a police officer. She's a trial attorney with her own law firm called, law firm's called R.C. Charles Esquire. And we have Dr. DeLacy Davis. He's a retired police sergeant and the founder of Black Cops Against Police Brutality, BCAP. And last but certainly not least, my entertainment lawyer, Dwayne Harley Esquire. I've got nothing to pitch lately until I get into the IFP thing, and I'll call you back. He's an entertainment lawyer and the president of D. Harley Law PC. So DeLacy, let me start with you. Do a quicker introduction of yourself, maybe like 30 seconds, and we'll get a little bit of each person so that when people turn it on, they can at least know why you're here. Oh, we got Larry then got into the house. Larry. Hey, Larry. Oh, good. So
how you doing?
Larry came in. Hi for Larry, y'all. Larry.
I'm on the road. It's gonna be hard.
You know I know. But you know I know Larry, so we gonna get you.
Just be careful.
Be careful. Larry. Okay, so DeLacy, we're gonna introduce you. So each person introduce themselves and we'll let Larry go last. What you're doing lately. Anything new you wanna share?
Your introduction is fine. Most recently I did research called Police Use of Force, examining the factors relating to police officers shooting unarmed Black males. I use a North Jersey Police Department and firearms and scenarios and looking at the reaction time and error rate to see if in fact we could identify implicit bias in the study, which of course we did.
Nice. Rosalind Charles, I know that you know you work extensively for people who are underserved as well. Can you talk about some of the work you do? Because you're not just a person in law enforcement in that
well,
way.
Well, I am a practicing attorney. One of the things I guess I bring to the table is that I've done defense work as well as prosecution. I have also served as a municipal court judge. And a lot of what I guess it's melding all together is I was a prosecutor, I was a criminal defense attorney, and now, and I guess I remain a criminal defense attorney. I've shifted my practice a little bit to civil, but I do a lot of trial work. So I've seen a whole lot.
I'm sure. Jewel, can you talk a little bit about some of the work you do in your activism? Because I think you're on the front lines of not just Black folks. You cut across the LGBTQ+ community that is very underserved.
Yes. So, as you said in the introduction of the work that I do, it is definitely centering Black people, specifically Black, queer, and trans people. And also, you know, girls and women and femmes, like that's definitely included in the conversation. Actually, what I'll share, I think relates to what we'll talk about today, is I did an IG live today at 12 p.m. where I talked to a recent high school graduate who is a Black girl in New York City and talked about her activism and how she feels very left out of the movement as a Black girl. And, you know, I've been really committing myself as to how important it is to have these conversations with the people who are impacted the most. So instead of talking like about them, which I think is important, you know, like we'll talk about that here, but what does it mean to actually talk to Black girls and what does it mean to talk to trans people directly, right? Versus having conversations of ways we can support them, but by actually asking them what they need in real time. And that support looks like in the moment and beyond. So a lot of the work that I do is really rooted in like one-on-one trying to figure out what to do and then using my platform to amplify the voice and the conversations.
Nice. And Dwayne, anything else you want to share? Because I know that you're not just a lawyer, but you really care about you know the Black community beyond that. So you use your profession to also expand into activism in some ways as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I like to sometimes refer to myself as an edutainment attorney because many of my clientele are obviously African American, Black, who are coming from communities who haven't been introduced to contracts. So a lot of times they're getting in these deals, and that's another way they abuse our bodies, getting in these deals that they just rip us off. So you have a lot of our clientele who are legends in this industry are flat broke because the reality is the contracts they signed years ago, even though it's 20, 30 years ago, still affects their life today, publishing and everything else. So I kind of explain and like educate all my clients the ramifications of every deal. Just because there's a contract in your face does not necessarily mean you need to sign it. And I think a lot of our people, some unfortunately our young people, they think that's a win by someone's offering them a contract. And usually, oftentimes, unfortunately, it really isn't. That's just the beginning of the nightmare. But I also am an adult advisor for the Youth Advisory Board here in Teaneck, New Jersey, in which basically we develop young advocates. So young students who need voice, who really don't know where to go or how to express themselves, if there's an issue that they're concerned with, it could be on a plethora of ways that their issues in their life, not necessarily what we think is important, but from their perspective. So they come to our this group and we put together a whole platform in which they can express themselves to the city council, to the board of education, to wherever it needs to go pretty much. And they advocate for their issue and we'll stand 100% behind them until to the end.
Oh, nice. That might have to be a documentary for Lisa Durbin. We got to talk, Boo. That's some content right there. You know I'm looking for content. Okay, so Larry done disappeared again, but he'll pop back in when he gets a chance because Larry's, people don't know, so this is going to be a little unorthodox when Larry's here because Larry's running for the Senate. He's running against a very popular senator, Cory Booker, and he wants to just take him on. So it's going to require him to be all hands on deck, boots on the ground, and really not getting any sleep. So he's kind of doing triple duty, so I appreciate him coming into these Zooms. So let's get right down to it for this week's podcast episode. We didn't get a chance to talk about the unfortunate situation with our sister, Breonna Taylor. And I want to call this episode that we're talking about, Say Her Name, because that's a hashtag that was created by our sister, I keep forgetting her name. I'll get back to her name again. But anyway, it's a hashtag because a lot of Black women's pain and brutalization and deaths and rapes and all kinds of abuses are not only not taken seriously by the white community, Black folks don't care about us either in general. So I wanted to take a pause because we've had many murders and many brutalizations of Black people and Black bodies with the police. And women in particular are brutalized by the police more often than we want to know, and raped as well. In this particular case, we know that Breonna Taylor was sleeping in her home, just to give you guys a context, for those of you who've been under a rock. She was sleeping in her home with her boyfriend. She's an EMT worker, trying to become, certified EMT worker. She's a young lady at, I think, 26, 27. And so the police officers came in plain clothes. They had took a battering ram and burst the door down and came in the house blazing and shooting up the whole house and killed Breonna while she was asleep. This was a no-knock warrant because they were so-called looking for some guy for drugs. I don't know who. I don't know what's going on, but they were looking for some guy with drugs. And the guy they were looking for was actually already locked up. A, B, they didn't even identify themselves and say, hey, where the police officers coming in? C, the boyfriend thought there was a robbery in progress. E, I mean, I don't know what letter I'm on now. So he pulled out his legal license gun to now try to protect his home, which Black women are very critical about Black men not protecting us. This brother was standing up the right way, protecting his woman and his home. And he shot one bullet in the air, and I guess it hit one guy in the leg, and they just went ballistic and shot everything up. So that's the context. So that's, hold on for a second. So that's the context. So let's kind of get into this conversation about, for you guys, because I want to talk about where you were, what were you thinking at the time that you learned about her murder, and what was your reaction to it, just as a person, as we unpack this tragedy, because I want people to realize that I'm not having you on here just because you have you're professionals in the area, but you're people too. Where were you and what was your reaction when you heard about it? We can start with Ms. Charles.
Well, when I was able to get at least piece together some of the information regarding the whole incident, it was clear it was pursuant to a search warrant. And it just seemed like a total bungled investigation. From what I understand, not only were the targets of this investigation already arrested some earlier that evening or maybe the day before, so it was both a tragedy and a bungled police investigation. Now, what I don't know, what I've not been able to become what is not available, I'd like to see what the underlying investigation is, because not only did the police officers, when they finally came around to, they arrested the boyfriend, but they wrote false police reports afterwards. And anyway, there's this, you know, I'm just wondering what kind of redress will Breonna ultimately get? Yes, charges, I believe, need to be filed. And then the question becomes the lead up, because with a search warrant, there's an application. So there's certain data that's put into that application. With a search warrant, there are also police reports. There may be surveillance. I'll be curious to see how tight their investigation was, because from what I understand, Glover, the person they were looking for, knew Brianna maybe or may have known her. There's a lot of missing information, and I just feel so bad for this woman who was clearly not just a human being, but a productive member of society who you can't sleep now. You can get killed while you're sleeping. You get killed while you're jogging. You can get killed while walking to the store. That's where I am. Yeah. And I'm just a little lost behind the whole thing.
Sleeping while black. It keeps getting longer. Sleeping while black. I'll put that hashtag when I promote it. Dr. DeLacy, I know you have a lot to say because you were a police officer who wasn't just an officer. You cared to put officers in their place who didn't belong there and didn't deserve to be on the force. So you were always on the front lines of fighting police brutality. So what were your thoughts when you first heard about this sister, Breonna Taylor?
So there are a couple of things that are missing in the context. One is allegedly that it's a no-knock warrant, but it's a no-knock warrant that was being executed with the other warrant. So there were two locations. The primary location and the secondary location was allegedly where drugs had been shipped to at least once. So that was the location where Ms. Taylor was living. So that was the So that's why it was a simultaneous raid. The other issue, no knock warrant, there's no body worn cameras, there were no drugs found. So that invalidates, obviously, because I know people are talking about, well, if they had the person in custody, then why they raid the other location? Well, because they believed, and to the judge's point, they believe they had a good investigation and they believe that the information was good. So we're raiding both locations because the expectation was we catch the person at the primary location, but we catch a stash house at the secondary location, which turned out not to be that. The other piece is that, of course, Mr. Walker, her boyfriend, defended her and he defended the home. I thought it was interesting. His comments were that he feared, through his attorney, he has expressed, he feared for his life and for the life of his girlfriend, which is usually what the police say, right? So he flipped that conversation and said, I'm in fear of you losing my life. And it's only been last month that they dropped the prosecutor dropped the charges against him, but they've reserved the right to bring them forward again.
Attempted murder charges, no doubt.
Absolutely. And because he did shoot one of the officers in the leg. Mm-hmm. However, I believe that they're simply waiting for the climate to change to determine, because remember, prosecutors in other parts of the state are elected. And so they absolutely are subject, even though they will argue they're not, to the political winds of the community. So that's my concern for him. Relative to her, they shot her 8 times. And so, I mean, they most recently fired the officer involved with the shooting, Brett Hankison, but I'm a firearms instructor. And so you were taught target recognition and target acquisition. And so my understanding is that he shot through a door or through a screen or through something that was covered, hitting her 8 times. At the end of the day, while you may have the authority to use deadly force, if you do not recognize what you're shooting at, then you are still liable for each bullet that exits your gun. And so in my mind, the training generally is one of double tap. So your very first encounter is you're firing 2 shots, pop, pop, because you're trained that way. But if in fact you're firing 2 shots and they allege that they shot because Mr. Walker fired at them. Mr. Walker said that he heard banging at the first entry point. There was no identification that we are the police. There was no badge, and he thought they were being attacked by people in plain clothes. That's similar to the Amadou Diallo story. The only difference is that Mr. Diallo didn't have a weapon to defend himself, but that is the same excuse argument that the police used in New York City. So when I see this, unfortunately, I think 29 years of doing this work in advocacy with Black cops against police brutality, emotionally, I try to detach. Because if you don't detach, you will be dragged down into it, and you can't live a civilized life. In fact, like some people say, if you've been Black, particularly male, but female now, but if you're Black and in this country and you haven't thought about killing yourself or somebody at least once, you're already far gone and we need to get you some help, because this stuff really weighs heavily on you. And certainly as we're beginning to see younger and younger Black men and women being murdered by the police, is problematic. And my final point is that this is why I've been so critical of Black police officers not finding the testicular fortitude to simply look down and pull them up and stand up for our community, because they expected when we joined these forces coming through the 70s and forward that having more Black officers would make a difference for Black people, and it has not in significant ways. And I mean, there's a rationale for some of that, and we know about the Carrie O'Horn story, which we'll talk about in another episode, but at the end of the day, Black police officers have to find the courage to stand up in our community and do what we took an oath to do, and or our community should run Black police officers out of the community.
Testicular fortitude is going to be my new hashtag. Hashtag testicular fortitude. Dwayne, can you follow that?
Oh, wow, that's powerful. Yeah. But I agree with everything Dr. Davis spoke about. 100%. Also wanted to add that I do believe there's definitely a cover-up happening along the lines of everything that's going on, because the police officers lied to the mother of Breonna Taylor when she got to the scene. They wouldn't tell her exactly what was going on. It's so much they even told her she was at the hospital already and she wasn't even in the site, at the site. And then from that point on, they kept continuing lying and lying and changing the story until everything had to come out at this point. So we still don't know all of the information, because they're holding on to everything. They haven't really told the public everything yet. And the fact that the prosecution has not charged any of these officers, I think that goes along the line, is going to be a continual cover-up, nonstop.
I agree. You're freezing a little bit, so I don't know if you can get that back, but you're freezing a little bit. We heard your words, we just didn't see you. You just frozen. So
yeah, I'm afraid to touch it.
No. Then you know, just go back out and come on back on your phone, because I just think it's better to be on your phone. And then just, okay. you hear us as well, but we'll hear you better and you'll look better. Jewel?
So I found out about the assassination of Breonna Taylor through social media, which is, I think, where a lot of people are getting their information, right? And I just immediately started seeing the hashtag. I started to see, say her name, including that. And I was just like, what is going on? And then I did my own research outside of that. So one, I will say that, as part of a generation that does get a lot of our news on social media first, when we wake up in the morning and we start scrolling, I think that it's really jarring to receive news like this in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of a race war that is impacting Black men, is impacting Black women, is impacting Black girls, is impacting the trans community, the queer community, and it is exhausting. It is disheartening. And when I think about what happened to Breonna Taylor, she's a few years younger than me. And I can only imagine that there's very few moments that really we're at our guard down. And I feel like definitely sleeping is the top two out of them all. And I also think that what I was reading about, which is the characterization of which Black people are murdered when they tell the story, and they're like, well, she had a previous, a previous relationship with the person who they were looking for. And so to me, that's giving, oh, you were a person who sells drugs girlfriend. You were the drug dealer's girlfriend or ex-girlfriend. It doesn't matter. And I think that's the character assassination that usually happens when we talk about Black people. We see this oftentimes with Black men, but it happens to Black girls, Black women and girls too. And that piece was very jarring to me, because I'm like, why does that matter that she knew someone who sold drugs? Like, that's, and I think also, I don't know the protocol.
Just Dwayne, stay right there, Dwayne. Just stay right there. Don't do anything else, Dwayne. Just stay right there. Go ahead. Do nothing.
And I don't know the protocol around police officers and warrants. And I can never for the life of me understand why, a no knock would also be accompanied with them being plainclothes, because anybody would assume these are people who are not officers entering your home. And we do have the right, supposedly, to bear arms, which we know does not apply to Black people. And I feel like the exercising of that right shows that we can't protect our homes because police officers really get to do whatever the fuck they want to do. And I think that this is the telling of it, because they can enter the homes with uniform, without a knock, without uniform, knock, no knock, and this is the solution or the end result is the same. So very disheartening, and just a tragedy all around. And I also, and the last piece that I'll share is, when I heard about the murder, I also was like, there's not gonna be justice for her in the ways that there's gonna be justice for Black men. And that also felt very disheartening. And I was like, well, maybe we might get a week of justice with Breonna Taylor, but then after that, people are gonna go right back to doing other things, because Black women and girls are not at the forefront when we think about ending violence and getting justice for our lives. Unless we're someone's sister, mother, unless we're related to people biologically, that's when we matter.
Even then it don't matter, because I've heard
even then it doesn't matter.
I've heard people who have sons and daughters still talk about, I got Black sons, and they have sons and daughters. So to your point.
Right, right. And I think that, like, we're always left out of the conversation with police violence. It's always like, I'm so scared for my son. And it's like, well, clearly you need to be scared for your sleeping daughter as well.
Exactly. And just to let you know, I remembered her name. I'm getting old. The woman who started the hashtag say her name, and now it's become a movement, is Kimberly Crenshaw, K-I-M-B-E-R-L-E. I didn't look it up. It just came back to my brain. Kimberly Crenshaw. And she's doing a lot of work. She just spoke in front of Congress recently. So that is precisely correct. And I have been on the front lines of girls for years. I just finished a documentary short called Girls Matter. I've written about women and things like that. So I'm with you 1,010%. But let's do something really quickly. Even if you have heard the 911 police call, others who are watching this may not have heard the 911 police call by Breonna's boyfriend, Kenny. So let's listen to the 911 police call. I think it's really brief, and we'll come back and talk about it, okay? So let's see here if I can get this police call. Okay, here we go.
Did anything that happened, he didn't come to speak, because I felt like this.
I don't know if I can get the, let me go back out. Let me try to get the police call. If I can't get the police call, well, I'll just put it in the edit, because I think that 911 police call that I want others to hear is extremely important, because this man wasn't out there trying to, here we go, trying to kill anybody. Okay, here we go.
911, operator Harris, what is your emergency?
I don't know what's happening. Somebody kicked in the door and shot my girlfriend.
Okay, where are you located?
I'm at 3003 Springfield Drive, apartment 4.
3003 Springfield Drive, apartment number 4?
Yeah. Oh my God.
Okay, how old is your girlfriend?
She's 26.
Brittany, oh my, you said 26? God. Where was she shot at?
I don't know. She's on the grill right now. I don't know.
Okay.
Mama.
You said she's 26. Is she alert and able to talk to you?
No, she's not. Breathe. All
right. Okay. You said you're in apartment number 4.
Help. Oh, my God. Yeah, help.
What's your name, sir?
Oh, my name is Kim Walker.
You said Kim?
Help.
And you said she's 26?
Yes.
Okay, you said 3003 Springfield Drive, apartment number 4?
Yes.
Okay. Can you see where she's been shot at?
I can't get on
the stomach, no. Okay. Is she alert and able to talk to you?
No, I'm breathing. Okay. Oh my God.
Can you get her turned over on her back? I need you to check her and see where she shot it.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Kenneth, can you hear me?
All I can think of is that ringing, and maybe you guys can talk about your reaction to that. I hadn't even heard this until I started doing research for the show. They didn't drop that on any of the social media, on the news or anywhere, When I heard that 911 call, and then he said, I gotta go, I'll call you back. And then she tried to call him back. I'm guessing she was trying to call him back because she's 911. And it kept ringing. That's when the shooting was happening. I don't know what was going on, but I'm telling you, I hate even listening to it. I got chills again. I had a visceral, ill reaction to that. I saw you taking notes, DeLacy. I mean, what do you guys want to say about that? That was sickening that this man is there trying to protect his girlfriend, Breonna Taylor, and he's afraid and he's scared and he gets arrested for attempted murder. And 911 is joking your town, like the old rap song said, a black person can't call 911. They're not victims. This man is arrested as a murderer and he's actually the victim. What is your reaction to this 911 call? I got sick.
Well, unfortunately, and I hadn't heard it, and I try not to listen to it because of the trauma. And what it does is it further traumatizes our community because the trauma is primary, secondary, and tertiary. So it's whether you experienced it, which is what he experienced, whether you witnessed it, which is what we're witnessing, or what you heard about, which is what Jewel talked about in terms of how people get information. It's all traumatizing in our community and difficult. From a professional point of view, what I was listening for was trying to listen to the keystrokes of the call taker and wondering if in fact they were dispatching an ambulance simultaneously because she was asking too many questions and she was still typing. Because I worked in a 911 unit during my career, I was listening. So what we would have done, and this was pre-advanced 911, but what we would have done was immediately had someone start running to the location while still taking the intake information. I was listening to the intake information, but she was still typing. And I'm actually going to call one of my colleagues that runs a unit in a major city to find out if, in fact, there is a key to push to get the rig started while you're still typing. Because if not, then that concerns me because it means there's a delay in terms of getting medical treatment there while you're doing what the protocol requires, which is that's why she restated the address the second time. But what we would have done when I was in East Orange is I would have instantly said, I need a rig to this location for a shooting, start a supervisor. That would have happened before I asked any more questions. And then I would have asked the questions along the way and informed the responding patrol cars and also informed the EMT rig.
Wayne, I see you looking very, you know.
Yeah, it's heart-wrenching. I mean, the reality is, you know, they came in and basically murdered her in front of him. And yeah, he became the victim and it seemed like he has no recourse himself. He may have, a civil suit for some type of trauma or an assault, I guess, against the police department. But other than that, like Mr. Davis, Dr. Davis has said, they're reserving the right to bring murder charges against him down the road. So this may just still will never end for him.
Rosalind, Charles, you wanted to say something about that? And then we'll get a reaction
to the call itself. And I'm not exactly clear on how they were attempting to use it against him. But in some of the readings I was doing about this incident, they, meaning the state, the prosecution, was trying to suggest that he hung up on the 911 call during the in other words, he stopped the call on purpose for some reason, some nefarious purpose that allowed them to hold him longer in jail. And I was just thinking generally, just outside of the incident itself, but just how we talk about brutalizing black bodies, they don't recognize our humanity. This man has just gone through an extraordinary experience where his girlfriend was killed in front of him. And we're not supposed to have emotion. You know, we're not supposed to feel. It just goes back to just generally how oftentimes we as a people are thought about it. We don't feel pain. I bet there, you know, it's just, that's, it really just hit a visceral point with me. Redress, you're right. Maybe a civil suit on some level. I personally don't think that this climate is going to permit a murder charge or an attempted murder charge to move forward. They would have to wait years if they wanted to proceed. And I would hope that whoever represents this gentleman can at some point get the state to move, motion the state to dismiss the charges against him with prejudice. Because again, I don't think it's politically palatable. I don't necessarily think there's a jury out there that would convict him. He was defending his home, but maybe you never know. Where is this, Kentucky?
Yes, Louisville.
Yeah, well, I don't know, but I just don't see that happening. Not in this climate. Not in this.
Jill, what was your reaction to the 911 call? Because I mean,
yeah, and I agree with DeLacy in terms of, like, you know, hearing these calls. I mean, the things that I feel like I've been watching over the last couple of months specifically, like, and it's like there's the processing looks different because we're in a pandemic still. So it's like, and I know for me, like, I live by myself, so I watch a lot of these things, and then I'm in my apartment, like, what do I do? And then I keep watching and I'm researching more and I keep watching and I'm traumatized and I watch it again. It's just a lot. So I think for me, the way that I read it was, or the way that I heard it or understood what was going on was that they bust through the door. There was, you know, he shot because he's thinking that these are intruders. They shot back. He's watching his girlfriend in real time die, right? So last breath, maybe coughing. Like, this is what I'm imagining in my head off of this call. And I'm imagining, like, the gunfire exchange already happened. So he's traumatized. Like, one thing that I heard, it was like, how old is she? And I heard, like, shuffling. And I'm imagining, like, him just, like trying to figure out, like, okay, 26. And, like, you know, what it means to, like, even know basic things that you would know at the ready. But when you're traumatized, even saying your name is hard. Or even saying your address is hard. And I think I'm hearing someone who just had a gunfire exchange with someone and probably didn't know that that was the police. Because the weird thing is when you call in the police on the police, because that's essentially what was happening. And they're plain clothes. So I don't even know if at that moment he knew, because he didn't say, I don't hear him say like, oh, these are police officers who just came in and killed my girlfriend. He's just like, people came in and killed my girlfriend. But to me, I was thinking about what could be going on in his mind. And like what you said, Lisa, that, you know, and you know, Rosalind said too, we're not allowed to feel pain. We're not allowed to defend ourselves. You know, I think when I think about our ability to defend ourselves, and you think about like Black Panther Party and just radical activists who've always said we have the right to bear arms and we have the right to keep ourselves safe, whatever that means. And I think that the hard part when we think about safety for Black people is that we know that the police make it so, in the way that the world is set up, that the one thing that we cannot keep, protect ourselves from is a police officer. We know that, like, that's just not a thing. And the system is set up so that they can bust through the door, plain clothes, all the things. And what we could do, our only right is to take it, to just take it. And I think about when we think of, like, we just don't have rights. We are literally, like, we're not humans in the eyes of the law. And that is a fact. And I think that hearing that was very disheartening. And I think speaks to just the trauma of what it means. And one last thing that I'll add is, it just reminds me of numerous murders when police have come in and they've murdered people, and the people around are so impacted, right? They're watching their loved one die. And I just speaking about that, I'm like, this is Philando Castile. This is all over again. This is happens time and time again.
I know Breonna Taylor's mother, Tamika Palmer Taylor, answered the question that people love to raise. You know, we're always some kind of way a criminal, even when we're the victim. She qualified and clarified the fact that the gentleman, there was two guys they were so-called looking for. First of all, the main person was in prison. There were two guys. They were in prison. I think the main guy was in prison. And the individual that they so-called claimed they were looking for, number one, never lived there. Tamika Palmer Taylor, Breonna Taylor's mother said, the man never lived there. Breonna Taylor and her boyfriend Kenneth did not know this person. They never resided there. There was never any mail there for the person. This individual has never resided there. In fact, Breonna Taylor's sister also lives there. And on the day when they shot Breonna Taylor up, luckily her sister was not home, because it would have been two dead bodies and not one.
Mm. Wow.
That's a fact. And I know, let me just tell you something. I live in Newark, New Jersey. I got very lucky one time. People lie on you every day. My best friend, Wanaki Allison, I'm naming names, her boyfriend at the time, Kaiega Banu, was with some chick in New Brunswick. I don't know. I don't know what she was doing. Some kind of way, the chick was doing some kind of dirty, and used my address to say where, here's where Kaiga Banu was, and something was going on. Because I guess she got the address some kind of way. People know you some kind of way. One day at 6 a.m., bam, 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 I get this loud noise at 6 a.m. They want to make sure they catch you when you're home. I get up. I don't let folks in my house. I live in New York. You ring the bell, you knock on the door, I ain't getting up. But it was like a real, like, bam. I opened the door, plainclothes cops, detectives looking for me, saying, does Kaiga Banu live here?
Mm.
Now, I knew him, but you from some kind of sideways bullshit. So I said, I know Kaiga Banu. That's my best friend, Wanaki Allen's boyfriend, but he doesn't live here. You see what that could have been? Mm. If they were the wrong kind of officers, and I said, oh, well, you know, and I broke it down and said, well, here's where he be at, and I gave my friend's address out at the time. You can find him over there. I said, but I don't know. She's not doing anything. I don't know what he's into. And I said, thank you for not kicking my damn door in. He said, I don't roll like that. He said, I try to, it would happen to be a white cop. He said, I try to respect folks. I could have kicked your door in. No, not warrant. But I chose to ring the bell, ding, 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 and bang on the door. Because I figured if you're home, you'll answer. If not, I'll kick your door. And then I got lucky I'm alive. Well, I don't know how lucky it is now. My life is a disaster, but that's not the point.
Now.
I'm on. But you know, so I'm aware. But let me just read something real quick, then we're going to move on with a rapid round of questions that we'll just point to some people to answer, and then we can jump in as we please along the way. I just have to say this because I say this all the time about women. Malcolm X, brother Malcolm X said, and it still applies today, sadly, the most disrespected person in America is the Black woman. The most unprotected person in America is the Black woman. The most neglected person in America is the Black woman. Sadly, that still holds today. I just had to say that since we're talking about Say Her Name, and this whole episode is dedicated to Breonna Taylor. So let me shoot some other questions out at you guys since we're gonna do this rapid fire round because we have about 15 minutes or so left for the show. So that's what we were talking about there. Let's talk about these no-knock warrants, shall we? So the no-knock warrant situation now, since the Breonna Taylor, I'm gonna call it execution, assassination, has happened. They've now passed legislation that the no-knock warrants, I guess, over in, I guess, in Louisville is no longer going to be able to be done. It's been
banned,
and I mm-hmm. think now they're trying to pass some national legislation that's going to work federally. So can you talk a little bit about that, Rosalind, about, like, you know, well, where we're at with it now?
I'll just say in general, from my experience in as a prosecutor in law enforcement, in fact, I was I've signed off of a lot of search warrants. And in my personal opinion, no knock, for the most part, is a fiction. There's a standard language that police officers would put into a search warrant that would say there may be guns there or some danger to their particular life. They wouldn't have to articulate it as long as they really wouldn't have to have anything specific to say other than I'm looking for drugs, and you know, drugs and guns always go together. Or or we want the element of surprise, we're looking for drugs because, so we don't want to knock because if we knock, then they can flush the drugs down the toilet or in some way or another. So I called it a fiction. And it was routinely signed off on and never scrutinized. Mm-hmm. And on some levels you got it and you understood it because yeah, I guess it could make sense. But I'll just say this. Yes, I agree that no-knock warrant should be, I don't know if they should be banned. I should just think rarely used, because I do believe that there could be that one or two instances where you're going after gun runners. So I don't think it has to be an all-out ban, but I think it has to be something that's very rarely used. But in general, I think it's a good thing that they are reconsidering the fiction I call the no-knock warrant. They just want to bust in with an element of surprise. And yes, they're also going to wear plain clothes, because if you go into an apartment building, you walk up there dressed as police officers. Well, I mean, that just kind of defeats the whole purpose of trying to execute a certain warrant, or at least gain that certain element of surprise. So
it's just, I'm hearing that and I'm like, there's so much nuance to that. Like, okay, anybody on this, and I know Lisa, this is your shot, I'm gonna ask question, but if someone just comes in your house, what are you supposed to do? Like, what are you supposed to think? If someone comes into my house right now, I'm not going to be thinking that's the police. So I get it, like the element of surprise. And
you're not.
But also, you should say who you are. That plain
absolutely.
Stuff, like, to bust in, like, I would not think, oh, these are officers.
With a battering ram. DeLacy, did you ever have the moment where you were on the side, because you've been detected in other things, have you ever been on the side of no-knocking? Where you've had to come in, or have you experienced it where you've been there?
I've been on a few raids, and there's someone with a battering ram, but there's also people identified as the police, and very often, because of the very issues you're talking about, there's at least a uniformed officer, so that you know that it is the real police with a patch from that agency. But usually there's some identification, there has been. And when it's been drugs, it does happen quickly. And as I was listening to all of you talk, I started taking notes because you know what Roslyn is saying makes sense in that we can't ban it completely, but you need to modify the use of it, because what it presupposes when there's a sign off on by a judge for a no-knock warrant, it presupposes that the person that's getting the warrant is going to be honest, has integrity, and they're going to do constitutional policing. That's the presupposition. The problem is we now know that that's just not the case in many cases. So what do you do? So when I've gone on a raid with this drugs, that's exactly what the protocol is on the other side of the door. They hear the police coming and announce that it's the police. People are moving and flushing all sorts of stuff down the toilet. Happens, or what we knew in apartment buildings, they throw it out the window. So we'd always have somebody at the window waiting, and they throw a half a kilo out to us, right? Just here you go, and they throw it. So that's the rationale. The problem is, you know, the pendulum begins to swing each direction. And so what's happening now, it's swung too far to the other way. Because our community, and I'm talking about Black people particularly, we are law-abiding citizens, and we want more law and order more than anybody, because we're the most people aggrieved, but we're aggrieved in the community by us, and we're aggrieved in the community by the police. So that is the problem, and that's why accountability for the police has to be swift and severe, so that they don't swing in that other direction, which is traumatizing the entire village.
You know, what's interesting is, in terms of Breonna Taylor and, you know, the whole hashtag say her name, it took, let's get this timeline down, I'm gonna call the assassination execution of Breonna Taylor happened March 13th, 2020. It took circa 3 months to about June 19th for there to be any action toward the three officers, and the actions were not in the arrest. So Sergeant John Mittingly, age 47, Miles Cosgrove, age 42, and Brett Hankison, I think that's the shooter, I'm not for sure. That's the actual one that, you know, shot her with the gun, 44. It took 3 months. They were working, collecting a check, and probably killing other people along the way between March 13th and June 19th, 2020.
As egregious as that sounds, that's quick.
Oh, damn.
Very.
Well, I feel, and you can tell me what you think, you know, I feel that even till now, nothing would have happened if Beyonce Knowles would not have sent that open letter to the Attorney General, Daniel Cameron. It's a long letter. Y'all can go out there on social media and get the actual letter. I'm just going to pull the three bullet points that we're going to discuss. And I feel that this is the thing that made the movement happen, because about 2 days later, then we saw the firings. In the letter, it said, yada, yada, ding, dong. But she said three things. Bring criminal charges against Jonathan Mittingly, Miles Cosgrove, and Brett Hankison. One. Two, commit to transparency in the investigation and prosecution of these officers' criminal conduct. Two, number three, investigate the LMPD's response to Breonna Taylor's murder, as well as the pervasive practices that result in the repeated deaths of unnamed Black citizens. Three, She called for all three. Not one of those things happened. They just got the firing. They didn't get the three bullets, but she called for those things. And so they did something. So I'm gonna go to Dwayne since she didn't say much. That rocked that department because they know that beehive gonna come for your ass on social media. You about to get dragged. So I think that at least caused some movement because there was a big lull, as you guys said, in it. And I think the lull was because she's a Black woman, Black and a woman, because we moved quickly for the other guys, Rashard Brooks and George Floyd and Eric Garner and these other names. But we don't want to say her name. Dwayne, I'll let you respond to that.
Well, I think Beyonce may have helped. I'm not sure if that was really the key motivation. I think the people in the street, you know, the protests, you know, the people that's burning down these buildings and busting up these windows, you know, they didn't want that coming there. They saw what was going on in Minnesota. They saw what was happening across the country, and it was gaining steam. I think they saw once the cops in Minnesota got charged, that it kind of swayed some of the angst out there. So I think they're probably doing the same thing in Kentucky. They were trying to get ahead of it, but they didn't go far enough because they didn't bring any charges to anybody. You know, actually, in all these cases, you really think about the prosecution. Although they had charges in Minnesota, how long did it take? How many prosecutors do you have to go through to get a charge? How many prosecutors in Georgia do you have to go through to get a charge? You know, and we still don't have any charges yet in Kentucky. So I just think they were trying to get ahead of it. Beyonce is a good, I guess, story, you know, you want to hear on social media to talk about. But I really think they was more concerned about trying to assuage the anger that's boiling right now.
Here's what I think. They saw the anger before that. They saw the anger before Beyonce's letter because that letter came out in almost the latter part of June, about June 17th, June 19th. They saw the anger with us about the George Floyd thing. They saw all the protests with the George Floyd thing. They saw people breaking curfews in Brooklyn, marching across bridges, writing Black Lives Matter on big old streets in front of the White House. They saw all the anger, but they knew there was no anger about Black women and girls. They know we don't care about Black women and girls because there was no groundswell of anger. Yes, there were a handful of marches and some whispers, but there was no real hard groundswell about anger toward Black women and girls' bodies being brutalized. So they were not afraid of that. They were actually afraid of being dragged by the beehive, which is even sadder. Okay, go ahead. Okay. That's my point of view. Okay, we'll move on to the next question then. with this question, this is what I want to talk about. And I think this is our last question because we're running out of time. So the last question we'll talk about, And then you can guys kind of leave us with the final point you want to make after this last question. So I want to talk about how does the intersectionality of patriarchy and sexism play a role, or how did that, do you think, play a role in the Breonna Taylor case, both in her execution and in the lack of accountability for her assassination? Because I do think that those things were all at play. Anybody want to start? DeLacy? Then we'll go to Jewel.
I have a different view because I think that Black people, period, have been ignored in this country relative to law enforcement. So I understand me being a father of daughters and you being a woman, I understand how you see it through the lens that you see it through, but I see it through a very broader lens. And that is Black people, period, have been treated similarly by law enforcement. In fact, this is probably the loudest pushback that I've seen and heard since Rodney King. And that's gotta be 30, almost 40 years. So they just haven't done it. I mean, Black people, and they've been killing Black people since Rodney King. So certainly Black women have gotten even less attention, but I think Black people as a collective, and I say that clearly that way because I'm not inclined to separate Black women from Black men. Because I think that's part and parcel of the problem that gets exploited, right? It gets exploited in such a way that I think that Black men even look at Black women differently because there are conversations that I have with men. I say, you know, I'm a father of daughters, so you can't tell me that and get me to sign off. because I don't think that my daughter is lesser than my son. I don't think my daughter deserves less than your son. And so at the end of the day, I have a I'm a girl dad, as I say, and I'm responsible for making sure that my girls are protected, both my birth daughter and my adopted daughters and my community daughters. So I think that, like I said, I understand the perspective, and I think there's truth to the perspective, but I think that so, you know, grandma was born 1901, died 1982, the youngest of 10 children, all her aunts and uncles were slaves. And so when grandma tells me the story, I understand that aunties were raped every day. That's how you get babies that look like me. You know, so it didn't just start here with the police. I mean, you come here darker than 1,000 beautiful midnights and end up light bright, damn near white like me because somebody's putting cream in the coffee and loving it, and it ain't just Mr. McDonald.
Hey, Rosalind, Rosalind was bouncing her head. Rosalind, then we'll go Jewel, then we'll do Dwayne, and then we'll wrap up with the last thoughts. Yes, Rosalind?
That's true. I guess to pick up on what the good doctor was saying is that, and some of the behavior of the law enforcement after the incident, they thought they could sweep this thing under the rug. They thought that they had focused their attention on the boyfriend because he shot at quote unquote police officers, and they thought that's the way it was gonna go. And ultimately, you know, fortunately, he was well represented. And now he is walking around a free man. He still has the possibility of charges hanging over his head. So now things have been exposed. So whether or not I don't necessarily see the patriarch, the hierarchy of the patriarchy in this case, but it could be there. But they basically thought they could get away with it.
Oh, yeah. Jewel, do you see where I'm going with it? We don't have to agree, but...
Yes, sis. When I was listening to Denise speak, I was like, wow, this is reminding me of... And it's like intent and impact, right? And I think that when I'm hearing that, it's kind of like, yes, all of our... Like, all Black Lives Matter, like, you know, whatever. And, like, that's such a fact. And also, it's kind of like, it also something like colorblindness. And you know how people are kind of like, well, I don't see color. All of us are the same. We all bleed red and da-da-da. I'm sure that for a lot of people who say that, the intention is to get us on a playing field that's like, we're all humans, human rights for everyone. But what that does is erases that we're different. DeLacy, if I die today, you die today, it's different. On so many layers. And I think that I would love for it to not be that way, but it is. So when we say that it doesn't, there's no differentiation, it erases the privilege that you hold. And the same way for me as being a Black cis woman, and when I say I have the same experience as a Black trans woman, that erases her experience, because that's not true. Because what's gonna happen, there's layers of what's going to be said about me than what's going to be said about a trans woman, and then what's going to be said about a Black man. And what I also will say too is that what was said was like those 3 months, and that was a short amount of time. When Black men are dead, the next day there's an instant rapid response immediately.
Not
there's
only
never
by the police, but definitely the Black community. We getting out there marching.
The Black community, and who's at the front lines? Black women, Black girls, Black. Who visits people incarcerated? Black women, right? And I just want to say that it's while going back to right what Malcolm X said, right? That the level of our disrespect and just disregard for our lives is a smack in the face, because we fight for Black people. We're all Black people, but all Black people don't fight for us. Correct. Unless we're their daughters, unless we're their wives.
And a lot of times, that's not even them. Because, again, I've seen not always them, because I've seen lots of people, women and men, who have both boys and girls, and they're only talking about their Black boys and what they got to tell their Black boys when they go out in the streets.
This is true.
And how they got to tell their Black boys what to do when the cops come. And I'm like, but you have girls too. Are you doing that with them? And that people get pissed. Right. They block me on social media. I'm bugging out.
Right. But also, I just want to, and as a last point, then we got to like wrap up, that another piece too is that Black women and girls are told that our lives are supposed to take second to Black men.
Absolutely.
So it's like, we'll fight for you, we'll do this, whatever. The people who we're fighting for wouldn't have fought for us. The people who we're fighting for probably would have assaulted us, been a part of causing us harm, but we fight anyway. And that's why it's a double smack in the face. And I've been having conversations with Black women and girls and being like, what would that look like a day without Black women? What would that look like? Because we need to have a conversation.
Movie Chirac. Huh? Chirac was a movie that tried to attempt to answer the
question. But they took it to a whole other level. That was problematic with the whole withholding sex. Because it's more than that. But I was, like I said, I think that that's the piece that we need to think about. We need to think about, like, that is erasing male privilege. That is erasing it completely when we say that it isn't the same, because it's completely different. And that the intersectionality, which Kimberly Crenshaw came up with that term, is because race and gender are at the intersections. Because for Black men, there is an enjoyment of manhood that women do not experience. So that's that. But it's definitely, there's definitely differences, and we have to talk about
that. I'll let you talk about that, and then we'll all have a last point. Then we'll be out of here, and then you can say whatever your last point is, and that'll be how we close. I'm going to call it the fire starter last point. So you'll make your point about this particular point about the intersectionality of gender and all that, and then we'll do the last overall point. So Dwayne, you wanted to address some of these issues?
Yeah, I totally agree. I think women has actually gotten definitely the short end of the stick on a lot of these issues out here when they're getting killed by the police, because they're getting killed by the police as well. And we don't hear a lot about that. And I do think that maybe, you know, women have not been able to get their story out as where they need to be on these matters. And we kind of brush over a lot of issues they deal with. But we still have to be cognizant that we all still are all Black, even though we got different matters or different issues that come along. One of the things that's all equivalent is that the person at the end of a cop's murder is usually a Black skinned person, whether it be Black, woman, trans, whatever the case is. And we need to really stop that too. We need to focus on anybody, everyone Black, but also we do need to uplift our women who stand behind us all the time, who are in the shadows, who do not get the spotlight. Because this murder with Breonna Taylor should really be forefront, just like George Floyd. It's unfortunate George Floyd happened and Breonna Taylor's story kind of went to the side, but also did Ahmaud Arbery. You know, we stopped talking about him when George Floyd came out as well. So we also got to not really, you know, try to stay together and unified in this effort, right? Because it's all Black people getting smashed by the cops.
Ahmaud Arbery, no, they acted very swiftly and people got fired very quickly with Ahmaud Arbery. So there was no backburn of Ahmaud Arbery. That was
brought to light. That was months later, though.
No, I'm not talking about when we didn't know about the videos, because that was hidden by them. So nobody knew about the videos. I'm saying,
but it was still moving through the system.
The public knew, they moved fast. When the public knew about Rihanna, after we knew, it took three damn months. After we knew. I'm just talking facts. Okay.
Well, we kind of knew about Brianna, well, at least me, when the whole thing with Ahmaud Arbery started. Right? That
correct.
Was just kind of on the
correct.
Low.
Yeah.
It wasn't really like mainstream yet.
And I've heard even leaders say, well, we're gonna deal with Brianna's case, but we gotta prioritize right now. I've heard the words come out of people's mouths and seen them write stuff like this, literally. Sickening.
Yeah, and I think we have to really be careful too, because this is what we shouldn't be doing, I think, is kind of getting away from the reality issue is that who are getting killed, not whether who got killed first or second, or whether or not who should be on the bandwagon first or second, given the fact that we should stop these killings.
Right.
Right? Because that's the issue.
Right. That's the bottom line. So we're going to wrap up with the last words with my dope AF contributors. Thank y'all for coming. So we're going to do a rapid round of last words. We'll do one at the end of each episode. I'm going to call it the fire starter. Now, if you start this fire, I might use the clip online. So we got to dip this fire starter. Okay. So who wants to say their last word first?
Well, I would simply like to remind us that we don't control the stories and we don't control the media. And so the stories that get told, we may be telling it, but it's not being recorded or put out by us. And so someone else makes a decision about which story is going to be a priority and which one is not. That's number one. Number two, when we talk about, and Rosalind talked about it, that things are happening quickly, you need to simply just look back over history. As Malcolm says, history is best qualified to reward our research. Generally, it takes years for the things that you're seeing happen right now, from 3 months to 6 months. It takes years usually, and I've been doing it 29 years. And again, it's time, it's the moment, it's the politics, it's the environment, it's all of the above. So I just think we should be mindful of that, because certainly we're not controlling a lot of that.
Who's next? I buy that with a vowel.
Okay. Well, I'll just say something just from my own perspective. And Jewel is making me rethink certain things, because I think about just the way I was brought up. My father basically gave everything to the daughter, and the sons were second. At least that was the, and even to this day, they still say I got everything. So I'm just kind of rethinking how I perceive the intersectionality. So I'll just thank you, Jewel, for allowing me to take that in differently. Yeah. And yes, you too, Lisa.
Well, what I'll say, and what I'll say is, like, for us to think about, like, people talk a lot about, like, the perks that Black girls get or that Black women get, like, the ability to, even speaking about that, like, Black girls are allowed to cry and to be soft. Mm-hmm. Are we really?
And also, no, because I'm not a crier. No.
Right. See, I hear you. But I'm saying about, like, you know, society, right, and socialization, right. And being like, oh, it's okay. But even the idea of, like, giving it all to daughters, to me, I'm like, is that really saying that my life matters? Or is that still rooted in some patriarchal where it's like the equivalent to, like, let ladies first, like whatever. Mm-hmm. A lot of that is rooted in, like, is that really you caring for me? Or is that really about your masculinity? And so I've been really unpacking a lot of some of what chivalry is and a lot of things that we've been taught to be like, let's do this for Black women. Is that really protecting me from state violence? No, it's not. What's protecting me from state violence on an interpersonal level daily, right? When we think about Black girls matter, Black women matter, it's not just when we're a hashtag, it's not just when we're murdered, but it's our everyday. That means in the workplace, if you are a man and you know that your coworkers who are women are getting paid less, are you going to HR? Are you making a conversation around that? You know, and so to me, in your relationships, like all of the things, street harassment, well, like we need to talk about the different ways that men chip away at women on a daily basis. And that is why when I have conversations with Black men and they can at the ready say George Floyd, they at the ready can say Ahmaud Arbery. But then when I say, how about the Black women who've been murdered by police? And they're like, the sister who, what's her name?
Say her name.
What's her name? So that is an issue. And then being like, well, I don't really know what to say. Well, guess what? I don't have a script on how to support you, but I do it. So What I'll say is support Black women and girls in any way that they need while we're alive before we become a hashtag.
You get the last point, Dwayne. Start that fire. You're the fire starter.
Well, I mean, I totally agree with everything everyone's saying here, you know. I mean, but I think it's hard to really have this conversation in these few minutes because there is a whole history of this type of order. Right, and not to excuse it and not to or qualify it in any way, but the reality is too, if you look back at how you know, decades and decades of how Black women actually were the, a lot of times in the South, were the breadwinners and things like that, because the men couldn't get the job because, you know, white wouldn't let them work. I mean, there's a whole lot of things going on in that, right? So there is a lot of ways we need to come together, and men do need to show women a way more respect than we do, but we definitely need to start having that conversation. But also want to just follow up on the other topic we were talking about, all of the movement that's going on right now, and the bills in the House, and everybody's is passing these laws. I don't think any of it's going to matter unless we start talking about reparations, because that's the only way I think we're really going to get true way to become, you know, back into society the way we need to be. Because we're not talking about reparations. We're talking about body cameras, which we know that doesn't work. We're talking about, you know, laws about chokeholds. At the end of the day, George Floyd didn't die of a chokehold. Breonna Taylor didn't die of a chokehold. A lot of these people didn't die from chokeholds. So a lot of these things are just, I think, Band-Aids on gunshot wounds. They're not really dealing with the problem or the issue. So I think we need to really have a more robust discussion. And I'll leave it
okay.
with that.
Right. I like that. Okay, well, then that's it. That's the episode of Breonna Taylor. And what I'm going to do with this particular episode, because it's a woman, I'm going to really promote it. I'm going to do some, you know, group clips. You know how I've been doing lately for us talking about a good point? Then I'm going to do some individual close-up face clips when y'all said some hot shit. And I'm going to promote y'all individually with your name there, because I want to really build this up for this episode to be watched well, like all of them. And I think it's very important that this episode in particular gets the... That it gets the promotion that it deserves and gets the ears and audience it deserves. So when I say promote, 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 go hard or go home. Bye, y'all.
All right. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
10. I keep the camera hot.